Welcome everybody to today's presentation. We will begin shortly, but in the meantime, let us know where you are tuning in from. You can go ahead and put any questions you have for our panelists today in the Q&A at the bottom of the screen. I see Sue turning in from Rockland, Maine. Hi, Sue. Glad you could join us today.
If you do type where you're calling in from in the chat, make sure that you have it set to panelists and attendees. That way everyone can see where you're tuning in from. I think the default is just panelists. Idaho. I know Dennis and Carol.
San Francisco Bay.
Yeah, Dennis and Carol. I've traveled with them. Liz Fox, we know her.
She's Denise. Hi, Denise.
This is fun.
Another California.
Hmm.
We're going to give everybody another minute or two to make sure we get people tuned in, and then we'll go ahead and start.
Oh, Carol is reminding me that on their 45th anniversary, they had dinner in the Eiffel Tower. That's right. They were on the Oberammergau trip. Dennis was a gymnast at Penn State back in the day, if I'm not mistaken. Lexi.
Hi, Lexi.
Traveled with Lexi twice.
Yeah.
Jeff Nybert. I know some of these people. This is fun. Dawn and Candy Drees, also regular travelers. Rob Simon from Portrait of Italy. Eighty countries and seven continents. Holy cow.
We'll have to ask Carol what her favorite place was. Welcome to our first of our quarterly travel spotlights in 2021. It's so good to see everybody, you know, letting us know where they're tuning in from. And I can't wait to get you all on a plane to get you to travel again with us soon. I'm Kelly Morgani, Assistant Director of the Alumni Travel Program. As a reminder, this presentation is being recorded and all viewers are on mute. Closed captions are available for this event, and you can find the information in the chat, in Zoom, or in comments on Facebook. We have received several questions from those who pre-registered and will answer as many as possible throughout the presentation. If you would like to submit any questions now, we invite you to do so via the Q&A button, which can be found at the bottom of your Zoom window. Following the live event, you can submit any questions via email to alumnitravel@psu.edu. This is the first of a series of four spotlights we will be presenting in 2021. Each presentation will feature one of our trusted tour operators and a special guest host or past traveler that will share their experience. Penn State Alumni Association has offered group travel for over 50 years. Each year, we compile a varied collection of tours that visit destinations across the globe. Whether you enjoy navigating the waterways by ocean or river cruises, or traveling by motor coach, we offer 30 plus opportunities each year that visit all seven continents. Our tours are managed by some of the most trusted operators in Affinity Travel. Today, I am joined by Matthew DeRamo, Business Development Manager for Colette, and then later on by Tina Hay, the former editor of the Penn Stater magazine. Hi, Matt. Can you tell us a little bit about Colette and how they work with the alumni groups?
Oh, yes. Kelly, thank you for having me and, you know, truly appreciate the opportunity to work on another exciting trip with the Penn State Alumni Association. Kelly, to be frank, we work with a lot of organizations, but we do quite a bit in the alumni affinity market. Colette, for those of you who are not familiar with us, we are a 103-year-old company. We were founded in 1918. And really started out as a small motor coach company, regional in the northeast of the United States, and grew into an international tour operator. Currently, we offer around 180 tours globally to all seven continents, over 62 different countries. We have corporate offices in Toronto, Canada, London, England, Vancouver, Canada, and Sydney, Australia. So we are a global tour operator, and we're actually the largest and oldest provider of travel in the United States. And we're here to provide another wonderful trip for the Penn State Alumni Association.
That's great. One of our viewers, Wendy, is asking, what makes traveling with a group different than traveling independently?
In my opinion, and you know, from hearing from my clients over the years, I've been with Colette for the past 13 years, and I've had an opportunity to travel on too many to count Colette tours. I think it's just the ability to not have anything on your plate that you are required to do on your own. We handle everything from, you know, getting you from the airports to the hotels, booking your hotels, having wonderful dining options available. We skip the lines and the locations that we're traveling to. So when you pull in and you see a line out the door, you know, we skip those lines. Everyone's waving to you, and they may not be as happy seeing you pass them when they've been in line for about 2 hours. But it's basically the entire package. We really think of everything. But the most important part, in my opinion, is the tour managers. The tour managers are here to really make sure that your trip goes, you know, flawlessly to the best of their ability. They're there to entertain and educate, make sure your hotel's ready, that the buses are on time, and really be your confidant throughout your travel experience. Keep in mind, guided travel is, you know, it's a little different than it was in the years past. We have a lot included in our tours. But we need to give people free time to explore independently. People want to have that balance of free time and activity. And we do a very good job of doing that for our guests with very few options. We're a very inclusive company when you're traveling with Colette.
That's great, Matt. Of course, the question that's on everybody's mind right now is, with the unprecedented year that the travel industry has been experiencing, let's first talk about some of the added safety precautions Colette has instituted on all of their tours.
Yeah, absolutely. 2020 was probably the worst year, not probably, was the worst year in our company's history and probably everyone in travel. And even if you weren't in travel, it was a very interesting year. And we've done our best to try to get back to traveling, to give you an understanding of what we did as a company kind of get us through the pandemic. Number one, we ended up canceling all of our tours from March until actually this March, March of 2020 through 2021. All of our international departures were canceled, and we're still working on a 60-day process to canceling our international programs. We canceled all of our domestic programs, Kelly, from March of 2020 through the end of June, but we did start touring domestically in July of 2020. We basically started touring to the northern parts of the country, you know, the Yellowstones, the Grand Teton, South Dakota, Badlands, Colorado, places that we, when we're working with the local health officials, thought it was safe to travel. When we were implementing those tours that we were operating, we operated about 50 tours in the year of 2020, which is thousands less than we usually do. We implemented a wellness protocol, and we were basically testing out the waters to how we want to get back to travel. Keep in mind, things are changing on a daily basis, so we never know what tomorrow may bring. But the processes that we put in place were, number one, we were making sure that people were doing their own self-assessment. Were they feeling sick? Did they have a fever, sore throat prior to the trip? We're requiring masks on tour currently. We don't know what tomorrow may bring. We don't know what, you know, our tour in December or, you know, earlier in the year for the Passion Play tour will bring. But we know that we have these processes in place, working with our local motor coach companies. Are they wiping down the coaches constantly throughout the day? Do they have hand sanitizer available? When we did get back to travel, we social distanced on the coach. We made sure that we maxed out the motor coaches at 50% capacity in order to provide a safe traveling environment. The tour managers, we're only letting our tour managers for the moment guide one tour, and then they have to take 14 days off before their next tour. So we're trying to put the pieces of the puzzle in place. But the key to all of this, which is on your slide, is when there was a tour that was affected due to COVID and it was canceled, we gave our clients options. We offered them, number one, we would price protect them, which we did for the quite a bit of people, 33 people for the Passion Play and half the group for the Northern Lights of Finland. We offered a voucher for 105% of the cost of the tour. But the third option, we gave our guests 100% of their money back, including their insurance. We're debt-free as a company, and the reason we were able to kind of refund up to $150 million is kind of where our refund is right now, is because of our strong financial position of being debt-free going into this pandemic. That's so great. You're traveling with a trusted advisor.
That's fantastic. That's great. Yeah, and everything is changing on a regular basis. Several of viewers have asked about the possibility to need a health passport or other documentation that will be required to travel, especially internationally. Do you are you able to tell us anything you know at this time?
Yeah, similar to, you know, COVID at the moment, you know, things are ever changing. At this point in time, we are required. I mean, everyone is required. When you're traveling international, you're going to need a passport. Your passport, we asked, it is valid 8 months beyond your return home date. But however, please just stay tuned. Colette will be in touch with you if you're booked. You may need to apply for an electronic visa to travel to Europe in the upcoming year. It hasn't been implemented at this moment, but there may be a small fee for that, $10, $15, to apply for an electronic visa for Europe, something that they may be requiring. But really, stay tuned, and you know, Colette will definitely let you know ahead of time of any documentation that will be needed to travel on this trip, and we'll help you facilitate it as well.
That's great. Thanks, Matt. Currently Penn State's offering two tours with Colette. The first of which is the Northern Lights of Finland, which is scheduled for December 6th through the 13th of 2021. I know you have personally been on this trip. Can you tell us a little bit about your experience?
Oh, absolutely. This was one of my favorite trips that I've ever done. It's branded under our Exploration brand, which is our small group touring, where we take no more than 24 passengers on these groups. They're not big bus tours that were cut down. They are smaller group tours. My wife and I had an opportunity to travel here in March of 2019, and we absolutely loved it. My wife was actually pregnant at the time, so some of the activities she couldn't do, which we were a little bummed out about and really didn't even think ahead of time. We were so excited to get to traveling. But it's such a wonderful destination. It's an eight-day, six-night journey, and our guests will be on the hunt for the elusive Northern Lights and discover this fascinating country of Finland, which is considered to be the daughter of the Baltic. And, you know, some fun facts, Finland, for a lot of people that may not know, it's almost the size of California. So it is a fairly big country when you're comparing it to sizes against other European countries. It is part of the EU. Back in 1995, they joined the EU. However, they're still declined to join NATO because of their Russian neighbors. They want to try to keep the peace between the NATO countries and Russia to their east. But there's so much to see and do. And we pack a punch with this tour. But as you can see on the map, there is an inner flight that is required on this tour. And it's part of the package of for the Northern Lights of Finland tour. We're flying into the Arctic. So not only do you get to see the history and the culture of the capital city of Helsinki, we're also heading into the Arctic, into Lapland. And the reason we're going up into Lapland, it is one of the best places in the world to see the Northern Lights. So we're basically, you know, going on a hunt for the Northern Lights on this tour with a lot of fun activities in between.
Well, let's go ahead and talk about Helsinki, since that is the first stop that you'll make on this itinerary.
Yeah, so just to give you an understanding, you're looking at approximately around an 8.5, 9-hour flight from the East Coast of the United States. So we're offering this tour all over the country, wherever you're flying from, but roughly from the East Coast, you're looking at roughly an 8.5 to 9-hour flight. Please keep in mind, when you arrive into Helsinki, we don't have anything planned that day, the first day of the trip, and except for a welcome dinner. So the first day of the trip is really a day that you can kind of explore. You hit the ground running, you go through customs and immigration, and then you transfer to your hotel in Helsinki. The tour manager will introduce he or she, and then you have some free time. So I always tell people, go out and explore. Don't go into your room, you know, to try to take a nap. Go out and explore. But the city is located on the Gulf of Finland, across from the Baltic states. It's technically not considered a Baltic state. And you're going to get an opportunity to join a local expert in this vibrant capital. It's the heartbeat of Finland. And if the heartbeat of Finland is Helsinki, then the heartbeat of Helsinki is the local Senate Square. And in the photo in the middle, you'll see the Helsinki Cathedral, which is the iconic building for the city. And it was built for the Russian Tsar Nicholas I. You know, you're going to learn a lot of the history of Finland, both geopolitical and you know, you'll learn a little bit about their cuisine, and it has an up and coming cuisine. And we're going to get you out into local restaurants to taste that wonderful cuisine. But we're going to do a locally guided tour around the town to really give you a feel and then kind of balance it out with free time. But I think I mentioned to you, Kelly, when we were prepping for this a day or two ago, that when on any of our tours, feel free to ask if you can go in early or stay later. When my wife and I did this in 2019, we went in 2 days early to Helsinki. We like to have a little bit of free time before we jump on the tour. And we actually caught a ferry ride at our own expense, you know, not part of the tour, to the capital city of Estonia, Tallinn. And it was a wonderful experience. So anytime you're traveling with Colette, you can go in early, you can stay later. We can make those arrangements for you. So something to keep in mind.
That's great. Yeah, now you mentioned that flight that's included that takes you from Helsinki up to Lapland. Let's talk about that flight.
Yeah, so you're going to wake up in the morning in Helsinki, and we're going to have your bags packed. All of your hotel-to-hotel baggage handling is taken care of. We're going to go to the airport. Now, my recommendation when you're in Helsinki, go buy some snacks, because once you get into Lapland and you're at this wonderful resort, we do have a breakfast, lunch, and dinner scheduled for you. But in between, you know, there's not too many options for snacks at the hotel. So if you want to fill up and buy some adult beverages and pack them with you for your cabin, or, you know, you could save a little bit of money along the way. But it's roughly around an hour and a half to an hour and 45 minute flight. On my trip, it operated seamlessly. We weren't in any, you know, we didn't have any delays. It was a really quick flight up to Lapland. We fly into the town of Ivalo, at which point we transfer to our partner, the Kaksalotinen Resort in Finland, where, you know, very recognizable for those glass igloos.
That's great. Yeah, those accommodations. Let's talk a little bit more about those.
Absolutely. So we're going to be spending 3 nights in this Kaksalotinen Resort, which is in the heart of the Arctic Circle in Lapland. Please keep in mind, I always want to set the proper expectation for this resort. You're out in the middle of nowhere. All you see, as far as the eye can see, are evergreens. It is impressive. In fact, at the resort, there's almost like an air traffic control tower that you could go up and get these bird's eye view of the resort. It's pretty cool. I highly recommend it. But you're doing 3 nights in the resort. 2 nights are in the Finnish log cabin, a really traditional cabin equipped with a double bed, a bunk bed, dining space, a couple bathrooms, a sink, toilet, shower, private sauna. There is a fireplace where you can order wood for the fireplace. But you're doing 2 nights in a log cabin, and then you transfer on the third night to the glass igloo. And the reason we do that on the third night is because there is no shower in the glass igloo. There is a common shower that you can take, but the last night after that next morning, we're flying back to Helsinki. A lot of people just shower back in their hotel in Helsinki. But this resort was really known for creating these glass igloos. No one can walk up and see inside your igloo. If you would like, you can upgrade to a kilo igloo. A kilo igloo is on the third photo, which it's a log cabin and a glass igloo. But keep in mind, the reason we're going to Lapland is because we're out searching for the Northern Lights. It's cold up there. It's cold in Finland all around during the time of years that we offer this. We offer this November through March, which December and January are your best opportunities to see the Northern Lights.
That was one of our questions.
Yeah, we need snow on this tour, though, because a lot of the activities require snow. So we have alternative activities if there's not snow, but it's very rare that the alternative activities don't operate, because there usually is a lot of snow. Temperatures can range anywhere from single digits with highs into the low 30s. So that kind of gives you an understanding of the weather. I highly, highly recommend the yak tracks that go on the bottom of your boots. I recommend maybe some ski poles when you're walking around, because it can get very icy when you're walking back and forth from your igloo or your cabin or the kilo igloo back and forth to the main lodge. But there's a lot of things that we include on this tour, but you also have some free time to kind of meander and do some activities on your own. So the included activities are dog sledding, which I grew up in Western Pennsylvania, a small steel town outside by the airport of Pittsburgh. And I never thought in a million years I'd be mushing my own dog sled through the Arctic. I mean, when you think about it, it's unbelievable. And it's a lot of fun, and people of all ages can do it. We do a guided aurora hunting. We'll go out on the bus to a clear area to try to find the Northern Lights. We'll go for walks in the resort at night to see the Northern Lights. We have a reindeer safari where you lay down on this reindeer sleigh and they cover you up and they give you warm berry juice. And, you know, you go out and search for the Northern Lights. That was the first time that I seen the Northern Lights in my life, was on that reindeer sleigh ride. And we also have an opportunity to see Santa Claus. So we go to Santa's house and get to meet one of his elves who will be showing you around. It's a lot of fun. But those are the included activities. If you want to pay and do some extra ones like snowshoeing or snowmobile riding, there's really not a better spot on the planet to do these things than in Lapland. So there's a lot included. It's exciting. My wife couldn't do the dog sledding because she was pregnant at the time. So it's giving us a reason to go back again.
There you go.
My experience.
That's yeah, I bet she'll take you up on that too. Let's get to the highlight of the trip. I mean, really the reason I think most people are going to take this trip, which is the Northern Lights viewing. Tell us why December and what's the likelihood of seeing the Northern Lights when you're up there?
So the reason we do a 3-night stay is we're playing the odds in Caxalotna, not just because it's an amazing resort, but we're marketing this as we're trying to see the Northern Lights in this time frame, from November through March. But when you go in December, your odds are very highly likely to see them on a 3-night stay. Almost 250 nights a year, what the experts say, are the Northern Lights visible. So when you're spending 3 nights, you'd have to be highly unlucky not to see them. Keep in mind, your lodges have a little button that you can press to have them alarm you in the middle of the night to wake you up to see the Northern Lights. My wife and I was actually watching the home opener of, or not the home opener, the season opener of the Pittsburgh Pirates, laying in my glass igloo, looking up and watching the computer. And as soon as I shut the computer, after the Pirates lost, of course, I shut the computer, I look up, and boom, the Northern Lights are there. I wake my wife up. She yells at me for waking up a pregnant woman. And I say, get dressed. We're going out and see them. You know, so although you're seeing them underneath the glass igloo, it was amazing. You walk out of your igloo in the middle of the night and everyone's outside with cameras trying to take, on tripods, trying to take the photos. And our tour managers will let you know, ladies and gentlemen, download this app. This is a good way to take photos of the Northern Lights. But we actually seen them all 3 nights because I'm a night owl. Some people only saw them 1 or 2 nights. It all depends, because sometimes they're very vibrant green and streaking across the sky. Sometimes they're bluish and white. You know, they're a little more faint, but it's the cherry on top of a wonderful program. This was one of my favorite trips I've ever done, and I love to tell people about it and show my own personal photos of the trip. And I can't wait to go back.
This sounds like a trip of a lifetime. And again, to see them, be able to see the Northern Lights, especially in that kind of a surrounding. We have had a couple questions that we'll get to, but just as a reminder, if you do have questions for Matt, especially about this program, go ahead and drop them in the Q&A on Zoom or any comments on Facebook. We'll get to as many as possible. Judy is asking, are there any Christmas markets in Helsinki?
So that's a great question. What's the travel date again?
I'm going to say December. December.
Yeah. 6th. So absolutely. I would say with unequivocally the time of year that you're traveling, there was a great indoor marketplace. I want to kind of relate it to, like the Reading Terminal type market in Philadelphia. For those of us in Pennsylvania who are in indoor market with all sorts of food vendors, you could try different delicacies of Finland. So absolutely, usually the Christmas markets start coming up right after the Thanksgiving holiday, you know, in that latter part of November, early December. So yeah, that was actually something I didn't even think of because I went in March, but
right.
Yeah, that would definitely be exciting.
Yeah, we can check into that. Also, now this is a little sciencey, but Wendy is asking, what are the different colors of the Northern Lights? Why do you see different ones? Do you know the scientific reason behind this?
I do not. And I know that, Penn State is very well known for their weather reporting up there, but I don't know the exact science behind it. All I know are the colors that we saw the first night when the tour manager was pointing them out was a really kind of light white that was kind of streaking across the sky. And my wife and I were like, oh, did we come here all the way from Western PA to see this? And he's like, but these are the Northern Lights. They change, you know, periodically throughout the night. It requires a clear sky. And, but there's green, blue, you know, maybe like a, like an orangish color, but those were what we saw. And the photo on the right's the one that I took. The other one's a professional photo. So the green one is what we saw on 2 of the nights. And that was taken on my iPhone on a little tiny tripod.
Very nice. Actually, one of our attendees had just said the colors are due to collisions, reactions between gas particles. That's probably beyond my scientific knowledge on that one, but good to know. That's good to know.
Absolutely.
Judy is in Florida, and she wants to know if any outerwear is provided. She doesn't have the necessary clothing for this. Are any of the jackets or anything provided in this?
Yeah, so I'm going to highly recommend a few things. You need a good pair of waterproof warm boots for this tour. I recommend, they're not required, but I highly recommend Yak Tracks. People were falling on our trip because the snow is can be icy once it's back down. A great pair of gloves and a scarf, and as if you were maybe going out to a Penn State football game in the wintertime. Now, that may not be sufficient enough for some of the outdoor activities. Right. So the resort does supply like a snowsuit with bigger, thicker gloves and some warmer hats when we're doing the sleigh ride or the dog sledding. So any of the activities that are included, the resort will provide outerwear for those activities because we're going to be out a little longer than when you're just kind of walking around and then going back into your lodge.
Great, great. Well, let's go ahead and, this certainly sounds like a trip of a lifetime. I'm going to thank you for joining us for this segment, but I'd like you to stick around. We're going to talk to you a little bit later on about another trip that we're doing with you. For those of you who are just joining us, this is the Penn State Alumni Association's Quarterly Travel Spotlight. I'm Kelly Morganti, Assistant Director of Alumni Travel, here with Matt Duramo from Colette. And our next trip we want to talk about is the June 2022 trip to see the Passion Play. For those of you not familiar with this event, the Passion Play has been performed every 10 years in the town of Oberammergau, Germany, for over 350 years. Normally occurring during decennium years, the 2020 performance was postponed until 2022 due to the COVID-19 pandemic. I would now like to welcome in Tina Hay, 83 grad from School of Business, former editor of the Penn Stater magazine, and consummate host for the number of trips with the Alumni Association. Tina escorted a group of 40 plus Penn Staters to see the Passion Play in 2010 with Colette. Hi, Tina. Thanks for being here today.
Hey, Kelly. Thanks for having me.
So I know you have hosted many Alumni Association tours for us. What is your biggest takeaway from these trips?
Well, I'm a big fan of group travel to begin with, and Matt talked about the benefits of group travel. It's kind of, you don't have to give it a lot of thought. You just have to show up, get on the plane and get there, and everything is taken care of for you. What's that?
And have a good time.
Exactly. You don't have to think about getting reservations, getting museum tickets, waiting in line, where are we going to eat tonight? There may be some free time built in, but right. A lot of it is just taken care of for you. And there's a lot to be said about that. But the other thing is the friendships that you form on a group trip. And that goes double, if not triple or quadruple, when it's a Penn State trip. Because instead of meeting 10 or 15 or 30 strangers, you're meeting people with whom you already have something in common. And it's really, really common on trips that by the end of the first dinner, the first night, people have already discovered that they had the same professor, they were in the same fraternity, they went to the same football games or whatever, and they have some things in common with each other that just adds an extra dimension to the trip. Yeah. A lot of the Penn State trips, I don't know what percentage, but some percentage of the trips also have a Penn State host who might be somebody from the Alumni Association. It might be a faculty member who has expertise in that area. Yeah. And that adds another dimension. Sometimes there's a reception in one of the major cities that we visit. For example, in Helsinki, there might be some Penn Staters who live in Helsinki, and you might have a reception and invite some of the locals to come. And that's fascinating to hear what they're up to and what they're using their degree for in this place so far from home. Let me just, I have some slides here. This is our group from Oberammergau 10 years ago. It was a very large group, I think 40 some people. So it's a particularly large group. This was in Nuremberg, Germany. And we'll talk more about Oberammergau later. I think I'm backwards. I'm just gonna pay no attention to me. Here we go. You didn't see any of that. This is a group photo from a trip to the Lake District in Italy in 2014. I'm not sure if any of the people tuning in might possibly see themselves in this photo, but this was atop the rooftop bar in Stresa, on one of the lakes in the Lake District. This is another group photo. This was at the Colosseum in Rome. But I wanted to point this one out. This was a reception we had in Bhutan. It was a very small Penn State group on that trip. I think there were about nine of us. Yeah. And we had the guide and the host all to ourselves. But we also got to meet the elections commissioner for the country of Bhutan, because he's a Penn Stater. He got his master's degree at Penn State. And so there you see him. And we offered a little toast in his name and got to hear what their country is like and what it's like working in politics in Bhutan. And that's a special thing that you wouldn't get unless you were traveling with Penn State. So that's part fantastic. Of the fun. Also on that Bhutan trip, people had the opportunity to climb, and I do mean climb, to the top of the Tiger's Nest Monastery, which is this quintessentially Bhutanese famous iconic monastery that clings to the side of a cliff. And this was my view of the hike most of the time. I was always about 50 steps and 50 feet in elevation behind everybody else. I actually was too out of shape to do it. I stopped at the halfway point and said, take some good pictures when you get up there and share them with me. But we've done some trips that were very active like this. And we've done some others that are more cultural and didn't require nearly as much physical fitness as this one did. This was a Penn State trip in China where we got to be taken on these bicycle powered vehicles into the Hutong neighborhood of Beijing and see how folks lived there. This was in Rome, where if you paid this gladiator a euro or two, you could pose for a photo with him. This couple actually got engaged on this Penn State trip.
Oh, wow.
Tom popped the question to Christine early on the trip, and we weren't witness to that, but we saw them coming back to the bus after they
had been celebration.
Yeah, exactly. Barbara Ratchford has been on a number of Penn State trips, and on our Amazon trip, she proved to be one of the best fishermen in the group. I forget what we were fishing for, but I can't remember if it was catfish or what, but she had no trouble getting that done. Another participant on, this was a Turkey trip, modeling the local style. And this is again from that Italian lake trip in 2014. We actually got photo bombed during this photo shoot. We had the bus driver taking the photo. We set ourselves all up, and you don't see it in this particular photo, but there was some local just decided to walk right into our photo and smile and pose with the rest of us. And we didn't even notice it till we were, and then he walked away again, and we didn't even notice it till we looked at the photos on the back of our cameras or on our iPhones, and we're like, who's he?
Very welcoming.
Exactly. So that just to give you a feel for what it's like to travel with Penn State. It's a whole different quality to it than it is traveling by yourself or traveling with any group, really.
That I would, I've volunteered many times to carry your bags anytime you want to take me along, Tina. So we did ask you to join us to talk about your experience attending the Passion Play. Now that was 11 years ago, which again is unusual. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Sure. And I think Matt is going to talk a little bit more about the Passion Play itself, but the legend has it that in the middle of the 1600s, there was a plague sweeping through Europe. And the villagers in this tiny village called Oberammergau, which is so much fun to say, pleaded with the Lord and said, if you spare us the plague, we will perform this Passion Play every 10 years forever. And so for 350 some years, they have been performing the Passion Play every 10 years. And the villagers all get involved. I think the town has about 4,000 residents. Mm-hmm. About half of them get involved. They announce the cast about a year out. The men stop cutting their hair. They stop shaving. They grow beards. Everything's authentic. The choir, the musicians, the ushers, the stagehands, everybody is local to Oberammergau, and they stage this fabulous play that is essentially about the last days of Christ. And whether you're a believer or not, it's fascinating and extraordinarily well done. It's all in German, but they give you a booklet to follow along in English. The music is great. I came home, I bought the CD and listened to it for weeks and weeks afterwards. It's really, really good. What were you getting ready to ask?
Well, I was going to say, and I think that you actually have to be a resident or a descendant from somebody who lives in the village of Oberammergau to participate in the play, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I believe that is correct.
Yeah.
So This, I like what Colette is, this trip was also with Colette back in 2010. And I think I see a couple of the people who are tuned in today in this group photo. But back in 2010, as is the case for the 2022 plans, the Oberammergau is the last stop. You start by visiting some other cities in Europe, and it all leads up to this village of Oberammergau, and the Passion Play occurs on the very last day of the trip. I don't have any photos to share of the play itself because no photos or video is allowed. In fact, this is the only photo I took inside the theater. This is a young man, Penn State grad, who took his mom on this trip as a gift to her, which I thought was pretty cool. And what's interesting is a very long play. You go in the morning, at least this was the case in 2010. You go in the morning, you stroll around the town, you shop in the shops, you get lunch, and then you go sit down and watch the first half of the play. And then there's an intermission, but it isn't exactly like a 15-minute intermission. You go have dinner. And you hit the shops some more and do a little more strolling. And then you come back, and about 8 o'clock, they raise the curtain and do the second half of the play, and you get out of there pretty late. So it's an interesting experience. It's really an all-day experience. So the only photos I have to show you are of us strolling the town of Oberammergau, which is a quaint little Bavarian town with a lot of interesting art, great souvenirs. You could see the locals showing up in their lederhosen. You can buy carved wood things. The sides of the of a lot of the buildings are decorated with what's called Luftmalerei. I'm probably butchering the German there, but it's a form of mural art that's found throughout Bavaria. And that's just marvelous to see. They're also very big in that region on wood carvings, which, and here again, the German word is Holzschnitzereien, and people buy those as souvenirs. This is the Oberammergau Museum. Have I mentioned how much fun it is to say Oberammergau? And cuckoo clocks are another thing the town is known for. I think Matt has one in his.
Yeah, home. I was going to say. I think Matt was showing it off yesterday to us.
Yeah, and at least one person on our trip bought a cuckoo clock to take home because that's kind of what they're known for. So it's delightful. It's a very charismatic, a very quintessentially Bavarian town, and then this historic performance that takes place once every 10 years is sort of the capstone of the trip.
Looks like Deborah and Harry were to the Passion Play in 2000, and they said it was fantastic. So I think we're going to bring Tina back in a little bit for some more questions with us. But again, if you have a question, go ahead and submit that question either in the Q&A via Zoom or in comments on Facebook, and we'll go ahead and get to as many of those as that we possibly can. But thanks, Tina, for talking with us. Once again, this is the Penn State Alumni Association's Quarterly Travel Spotlight, and I'm here with Tina Hay and Matt DeRamo talking about the 2022 trip to see the Passion Play. Matt, since the Passion Play is such a unique experience, can you talk about Colette's history in offering this trip?
Yeah, we've been offering Passion Play for the past 40 years when we started doing international travel. We are one of the top Passion Play partners, and just to kind of give you an understanding, it's not about how much money a tour operator has or an individual has to get tickets. It's all the tickets are tied to like a package similar to, you know, sometimes there's Super Bowl packages, but it's as hard as the Super Bowl to get tickets sometimes. But they're tied to the hotels, which are tied to the restaurants, because Tina hit the nail right on the head. It's a small little village, and they want to be loyal to who's loyal to them. Right. So if you looked at any of Colette's other itineraries that go to this region on non-Passion Play years, you always find that we stay in the village of Oberammergau. Most tour companies, and I understand why they do it, when they're visiting this region, they stay in Munich. That's where a lot of people want to stay. But we've always decided to give business to the village of Oberammergau, to show them our commitment to their village in off seasons. So when it's time to offer the play, we get kind of first dibs on the tickets. And it's really exciting. We've been selling this for literally 3 years. We started selling it in 2017. It'll be a 5-year selling process for this tour. which is kind of crazy to think that some people deposited in 2017 and they won't travel till 2022. But yeah. It's truly a trip of a lifetime.
Yeah. Yeah. And about how many travelers does Colette send to the Passion Play each decade?
So this year we bought approximately 14,000 tickets. So when you start dividing that by, 44 people per tour, that's quite a bit of buses that are going there. We had several different itineraries because you can't have everyone flowing the same exact direction heading into the village. But one of the key things when you're traveling to the Passion Play with Colette is, especially on this itinerary, it's not said for every itinerary, but most of our itineraries, we're doing two nights in Oberammergau and we're in the village. Now, when you're looking at the Penn State itinerary, it'll just say Oberammergau region. Now, we don't list the hotel or the place we're staying until around 30 days prior. We list all of our other properties, which we're very proud of, but they don't get assigned to the tour operators till closer in. It's part of that package deal. And with that package, we have tickets that are A1. So A1 goes with the quality of the hotel, the dining experience. Like Tina mentioned, we have dinner at intermission. So we leave at 5:30, we come back at 8, but in between we have dinner, which is part of the package deal. And don't be surprised if you're sitting across from Jesus at dinner time. It's not a big village. You'll see people serving you that were literally in the play. It's nuts how it's all hands on deck when they're there. But approximately 4,500 people can attend the play, sometimes a little more with standing room. But that A1 that I mentioned, I'm pointing like you can see, but it's the Italian in me, is the dark blue section of the stage in the bottom left-hand corner. That is the A1 where our reserve tickets are. Keep in mind, the stage is uncovered. So the actors and actresses are under the elements. So if people are attending this play in October, the early part of October when it ends, and it's snowing, and Jesus is coming in on a cross in the snow, that's how it's being, that's how it's being done on the play. You're undercover, and you have reserved seating. So it's exciting. About 500,000 people around the world converge on this little tiny town of Oberammergau, and I can't think that how ironic it is that this was started in 1634, while the Black Plague was going on, and now it's postponed because of what we're dealing here with COVID for another 2 years. But we're excited to have people on, and I think the itinerary you put together and chose for the alumni is spot on.
Yeah, this one's a little bit different than the itinerary that we offered 11 years ago. But this particular one encompasses so much of Central Europe. Can you talk a little bit about some of the other stops on the Imperial City itinerary?
Yeah, absolutely. We're visiting three of the most amazing cities in Central Europe. You're getting an opportunity to start your program in Budapest in Hungary. You're going to be visiting the Czech Republic in Prague. You'll be visiting Vienna, Austria. These are three amazing cities. We are going into Slovakia a little bit in the town of Bratislava, and we're visiting this little tiny town of Český Krumlov when we're heading into the Czech Republic. But you're getting two nights, which is nice. You're not packing and unpacking every single night. Even though we handle the hotel-to-hotel baggage handling, every once in a while, you need multiple night stays. You don't want to be packing every single day. And the nice part about this itinerary is we have a nice mix of that, that inclusion with free time. Right. So how it works is we're giving people a city tour, and then we're basically saying, the rest of your day is at leisure to explore after you get your bearings of the town. I know sometimes once people leave, they think, oh, if I came back here, I can do all this on my own.
Yeah. Well, let's start in Budapest, because I know that that's where this particular itinerary starts.
Yeah. Budapest is the queen of the Danube. It's also the capital of Hungary. And keep in mind, when you are in Hungary, it'll be the currency is the forint when you're in Hungary. So you're going to need a couple different currencies on this trip between the Czech kruna, the Hungarian forint, and the euro will be the majority of the currencies while you're here. But it's just such a wonderful city. Now you have Buda on one side of the river, you have Pest on the other side, and you know, it makes the town of Budapest. There's a lot of highlights when you're traveling around, from the neo-Gothic marble, the Matthias Church, which sits atop the Buda Castle Hill, the Fisherman Bastion. What I think is the most famous site in all Budapest is when you get a chance to see that Parliament House along the riverfront. It's just one of those
beautiful,
one of the pictures that, you know, you'll never forget.
Right. And then from there, you make a stop over in Bratislava on your way to Vienna, correct?
Absolutely. We never drive longer than, you know, an hour and a half to 2 hours without stopping, using the restroom and giving people an opportunity to see something a little bit different along the way. And that's what really brings this stop along. There's driver hours in Europe that they have to abide by, which strict. So we're going to stop in the capital of Slovakia, which is Bratislava. It's set along the Danube River and it borders Hungary and Austria. And it's the former imperial capital of the Habsburg Empire. And you're going to have some free time to walk along this 4,000-year-old town. You're going to have a local expert take you around. Then you're going to have free time for lunch. And then we're going to get on our way. And we're going to be making our way to Vienna. But that's one of those little pit stops where we do a city tour, give you free time for lunch, and then kind of make our way into Vienna. The nice part about that is a lot of time check-in times in these European hotels are not until about 2 o'clock. So if we time it perfectly, we don't have to sit around the lobby and stow our luggage at all.
Right, right. And then from once you're in Vienna, let's talk a little bit about Vienna.
Well, what's not to say? I mean, it's really a legendary city. It's the city of music. When you look at the composers that have come out of Vienna with Mozart and Beethoven and Strauss, you can't help but get captivated with the music scene of Vienna. But just strolling around the city streets and heading into the cafes and having some Vienna pastries and coffee, we're going to visit the Schönbrunn Palace. It was the summer retreat of the Habsburg dynasty for over 200 years. We'll have a little performance at the music performance while we're there. You can't be in Vienna without diving into the music history. It's the same thing. We're going to give you your bearings. We're going to have a wonderfully local guided tour, and then, you know, give you some free time to explore after you've seen some of the highlights. I know we were speaking with Tina before the presentation about, you know, how wonderful the Colette tour managers are. You will have a Colette guide with you, but then you also have step-on guides. By law in Europe, you know, it's required to have a local guide who will say, my name is Michael, I grew up here, let me take you on a tour of my city. And the Colette tour manager just kind of takes a back step and lets Michael do his thing for that day.
That's wonderful. And then from Vienna, where do we go?
So in Vienna, this is a cool little stop along the way. So we're making our way into the Czech Republic. We're going to stop in this really cool little town called Český Krumlov. The city's castle has a natural moat caused by this winding of Vltava River, which is located besides the Bear Moat. It's one of the best preserved medieval towns in all of Europe. And we're going to have that locally guided tour around the city. It's one of those similar stops to Bratislava. We're making our way to Prague. And on route, we, you know, are stopping, stretching out, having a city tour, getting some time for lunch and to do some independent exploration. But it's really this Baroque architecture that surrounds the city.
That's great. And then you don't actually stay there. Your next actual overnight is in Prague, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And one of my favorite European cities. My wife was scheduled to go in April with a friend of hers before this COVID pandemic hit. So we're still sitting on some vouchers for that. But it's called the City of 100 Spires. And it's just such a wonderful, Tina was mentioning how she was so happy to see this on the itinerary because there's so much to see and do in Prague. Personally, I like drinking a lot of beer in Prague. It's just very conducive to like a beer drinking town, but it's the former capital of the Kingdom of Bohemia and up until around 1918. And really the main sites of the city are the St. Vitus Cathedral, which really dots the landscape, and getting an opportunity to see Prague Castle, which is the largest castle complex in the world, and the Charles Bridge. You can't help but walk up and down the Charles Bridge and all sorts of street performers and vendors and musicians playing along the bridge. Now, this is a town which is so nice to have some free time because it's such a pedestrian city walking around Old Prague. We do have an option to take a locally guided tour through the Jewish quarter in Prague to see the rich heritage of the Jews. But it's such a wonderful way to kind of start towards the end of your tour with the cherry on top being Oberammergau.
That's great. Yep. And then that's our next step after Prague. So once we finish in Prague, then we go to the Passion Play, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things to keep in mind, I know we already talked about it, but the key of staying two nights in Oberammergau, what you'll find is when you're there for the play, bus after bus after bus is pulling in to Oberammergau to drop people off in the morning time frame. It can get a little frenzy because, all the people are coming in for the Passion Play,
right,
which is fine in the morning time. But what's nice for you is you wake up in Oberammergau, you head out, you have a leisurely morning, and then we get together for lunch, and then we make our way over to the play. The play starts at 2, we break at 5:30 for dinner, and then it starts up at 8, and then it ends at 10:30. Now, what you'll find is the mad rush back to the buses right after 10:30, and then a lot of them are staying in the Munich area, which is good with traffic coming through the Bavarian Mountains. You're looking not getting back to Munich until about 12:30 at night. So what's nice is after the play's over and you're so excited that you saw this once in a lifetime event, you can head to a little cafe for a nightcap or a little, bar and indulge in some German beer and pretzels. But it's fun just being in that town. Keep in mind, the accommodations are not our luxury four and a half star accommodations that Colette is accustomed to. They're more of a rustic accommodations when you're in Oberammergau. They just don't have the luxury, 4 and 5 star hotels. So have some reasonable expectations. Yeah, I always say it's like I kind of set the stage. It's almost like a national park lodge. A little bit more of it's a place to lay your head for two nights and you're there in the village. And
a little more authentic.
Like Tina mentioned, all the walls of the buildings, the facades are dotted with these fairy tale themes from like Hansel and Gretel to biblical scenes. I have my Colette background behind me. Behind that is a cuckoo clock that I bought. It's of a beer garden. And I ordered it. My wife told me, don't buy a cuckoo clock. And that was the only thing that I really bought on the entire trip. I finally put it in my office. But I bought it. They shipped it home. It came like 3 months later. I completely forgot I even paid for it. But there it's from the Black Forest. So it's a fun little town to go and find little religious artifacts. This is not a religious tour per se. It's just a play that has the story of Jesus' last days. So it's not a religious tour throughout. It is a tour of the cultural cities of Eastern and Central Europe.
And then we finally end up in Munich to sort of wrap things up.
Yeah, it's keep in mind, we always pride ourselves in our hotel location and our hotel quality. So I'm always trying to set the proper expectation when people are, attending presentations. We're at an airport hotel in Munich because the whole idea is to leave at the end of the trip from Munich. But we are touring around Munich, getting a chance to see, the world famous Glockenspiel, the Olympic Park, the main thoroughfare of Munich, which is the Marienplatz, this beautiful square surrounded by shops and restaurants. So we will have a little city tour around Munich after we're traveling from Oberammergau. And then we end with a beautiful farewell dinner, just like we get together in Budapest. We're going to, get together at the end of the trip as well.
That's great. Now this this tour, which includes this play, normally sells out very quickly. There is still an opportunity to join the Penn State family in 2022. Matt, can you tell us how many spots are still left on this trip?
Yeah, on this particular tour, we have 11 spots left. Please keep in mind, singles are very limited. I'm not even sure if there's any single availability left because this tour goes out with 44 seats and we sell every seat out.
Yeah.
In fact, we were sold out before COVID and then we have cancellations. So there's only 11 spots left, which is roughly, six couples that can get onto the trip. So act, sooner than later. And
Yeah. Well, to make a reservation on either one of these trips, you can visit our website at alumni.psu.edu/travel. And you can check on, click on the individual tour links, and they will actually drive you to more information, which you'll also get in a follow-up email from us. We do still have a little bit of time, so let's bring Tina back to join us in answering some of the questions. One of the ones, and my German is not very good, but Shelley is asking, is the play done in Hochdeutsch or is it done in a dialect? Do we know?
I wonder if that means like in High German. I have no idea.
Okay. I don't know what it was in German. Yeah, I couldn't tell you my Deutsch is not very good.
What about the bathroom facilities with that many people? We all know what Beaver Stadium is like during, you know, an Ohio State game. So what about the bathroom facilities at the Passion Play?
I don't have a recollection of that. Matt, do you know?
Yeah, I mean, everything just works out. You have a 2.5 hour intermission. So it's not like at halftime where everyone's going out because you have to be back in a half hour. If you have to step out in the middle of the play, I recommend maybe not drinking a lot of liquids ahead of time because you have paid for the Passion Play. But it's not like, you know, once you leave, everyone's going to the bathroom to get back in. You're strolling around the street. So it wasn't an issue in 2010.
So does Colette take group photos of all the participants yet? Is that something that you guys provide?
So at this time, we have no longer been taking group photos because of legal actions. You know, we had to get signed waivers for every single person in the photo, and we just wanted to wipe our hands. However, a lot of times what the tour manager may do, and a lot of them do this, is they'll find a spot where you can take a group photo. It's not something that's provided by Colette. The tour manager will just grab a bunch of cameras going back and forth and taking photos for people. Or they'll say, write your email address down and I will send you this instead of doing it all at once. Because a lot of people didn't want their photo taken.
Often when we send a host, our host will take photos of the group and then we try and share those out via email or on our website when the host gets back. So we do try to do that. I see a number of people who are looking to go to the Chesky's Kromlov to see their... Tina's laughing because of
we just wanted to make you say that, Kelly.
I know you did. You tried really hard on that one. But she just, a lot of people are commenting that they've either been there or they're looking forward to going there. We did have somebody who asked, actually, we've had a number of people who have asked, what is your favorite place that you visited and where do you plan on going next is what I'd like to know. And Tina, can you go first on that one?
Oh, that's an interesting question. I will say Prague was very, very memorable. We just got done talking about that, but
yeah,
I visited there with a Penn State group in 2003, and that city left such an impression on me. It's so charismatic and so photogenic. There's just so much to photograph there. It's just a great, great old world city. The Portrait of Italy trip that we do from time to time was also very memorable. It's a longish trip, more than 2 weeks. And it covers a lot of ground from the Amalfi Coast in the
all the way up
southwestern part to Venice in the northeastern part of Italy. And I have never seen a group of Penn Staters bond the way that group did. I think because we were together for so long and visiting all those amazing places together. So those two stand out as past trips. Where I'd like to go, oh my gosh, that's such a long list. I hope to get to Iceland this summer to photograph puffins. I was on a trip to Iceland last summer that got bumped because of COVID. I'm booked on a bird photography trip to Colombia in 2022. I've never been to Vienna or Budapest, and they're both on my bucket list.
Okay.
I hosted a Penn State trip to Spain and Portugal in 2019 and fell in love with Portugal, especially. I'd love to go back. And I have yet to see the Northern Lights. The Northern Lights are kind of on my bucket list too.
Okay.
So that ought to give you enough.
Yeah, what about
you, Matt? Dear Santa, I would like.
We used it on our Christmas cards, our photo.
Yeah, there you go.
Italy. I mean, no matter where I'm at, it's my family heritage. I can keep going back and back again and see something different and experience something different.
So diverse.
I just love the country, the people, the food, the cuisine, you know, everything that it has. And And I was supposed to be in Japan next week, was my scheduled trip. I've always wanted to go, you know, from the culture and the cuisine. I want to eat sushi and ramen all through the country. And, you know, so I'm really looking forward to my next trip, which is Japan.
Does that have snow monkeys or whatever they're called?
Our tour, I don't think would feature the snow monkeys. No, yeah, I'm not sure.
Cool. So Kathleen has asked if the Alumni Association offers trips to domestic locations. And we do. We offer trips in the U.S. and throughout North America. In 2021, we have a scheduled tour on the Mississippi River and one to Yosemite National Park. And then for next year, 2022, we're scheduling trips to Hawaii, Alaska, several of the U.S. national parks, and Canada. Some of the other questions were, I think this one went back to the Northern Lights trip. How many years has Colette been offering this trip? This is the first year that Penn State is offering it since I've been here. So it's the first time in about 15 years that Penn State has offered it. And, you know, we will look at offering it again. It seems to be pretty popular. Matt, how many spots do we have left on that particular trip? Because that one was also pushed. It was originally scheduled for February of 21, and we're now doing it in December of 21. Do you know how many spots we have left on that trip?
I believe we have 14 spots left. It's a small group tour of 24 passengers, so it's more of a boutique. We've been offering it since this will be the fifth season, if 2020 was a season. So this will be the fifth year. The great part about that is you're getting in at a good time, because when we first started offering this, it was around $1,500 more per person, land and air. So it is a really good deal. We did a very good job negotiating with the Kakslotin Resort. They wanted to see what type of business we can bring their way. And we've learned our lesson over the years. Like October, we sent our first group, which was my group from Central PA and in the Harrisburg area. And they arrived, and it was the first year ever, like in October, that they didn't have any snow. And so instead of dog sledding, they did a horse sleigh ride, you know, things like that. So, but yeah, this will be the fifth year.
Okay. So we will probably look at offering that again in the next 2 or 3 years then with Penn State. One of the other questions that had come up, and we are kind of running tight on time, so my apologies, is travel insurance. And while travel insurance isn't required, we do usually recommend that you consider the benefits of purchasing it. The Alumni Association, through USI Travel Insurance Services, offers a comprehensive travel policy. And you can visit our website for the link and compare the different levels of coverage. But I know, Matt, Colette also offers trip cancellation insurance. And can you just very briefly sort of touch on that?
Yeah, it's optional. It's due at the time of deposit. The nice part about our insurance is it's not based on age or pre-existing conditions. It's one flat rate per person for the trip. And it's canceled for any reason up until the day before you leave, and you get a full cash refund back.
That's a fantastic policy
and covers you while you're on the trip as well for trip interruption, travel delays, illness, accident, theft. And it's canceled for any reason up until the day prior.
And all that information, I believe, is available on your website. Like I said, we are running out of time. I could sit and talk to the two of you for hours. I wish we'll have to schedule some off time to do that. But I do want to thank both of you, Tina and Matt, for joining us today. And I think I speak for many of our viewers when we say that we're all ready to be able to travel again. Just as soon as it's safe, the Penn State Alumni Association would like to help you with those plans. You can find information about all of our trips at alumni.psu.edu/travel. I hope you enjoyed today's presentation. The Alumni Association offers a variety of virtual opportunities, and we hope that you'll be able to join us for a coffee talk with Paul Clifford, a virtual speaker series presentation, or at our next travel event, which is the Travel Showcase on April 14th. At that time, we'll be joined by AHI Travel, Go Next, and Orbridge Destination Specialist to talk about our 2022 tour collection. A full listing of all virtual events can be found at alumni.psu.edu. I hope to see you all soon. Thanks for joining.
Thank you, Kelly.
Thanks, Kelly. Thanks for coming, everybody.